Welcome to the American Humanist Association's Critical Minds series. My name is Emily Newman, and I'm the AHA Senior Education Coordinator. Today, I'm happy to share a conversation on God anatomy with author Francesca Stavrakopoulou. And I'm going to give you a little introduction to Francesca before I hand off the mic to her. She is a broadcaster and professor of Hebrew Bible and ancient religion. She is interested in biblical traditions and religious practices most at odds with Western cultural values. Francesca presented a three-part BBC documentary series about the Bible and archaeology called The Bible's Buried Secrets in March 2011, and she also appeared regularly on the BBC's The Big Questions and Sunday Morning Live. So thank you so much, Francesca, for joining us today.
Thank you for having me. It's really nice to be here. Thank you for inviting me.
Yeah, it was exciting to hear about your book. I feel like it, and I will make sure to pop the link in there in just a moment, and we'll share it along with the recording. So tell us a little bit about how you got into studying God and kind of exploring the big questions.
Yeah, it's a weird thing, isn't it? Because I'm an atheist. I always have been. I always will be. I wasn't brought up in a particularly religious household. I'm part Greek, part British. And so even though religion was kind of around in my kind of cultural family background and context, my family weren't particularly religious at all. So I wasn't, I suppose I was just intrigued by what I saw around me. So things like, you know, this Jesus guy, you know, what the nature of God. I went to a school where it was normal to like go to a school assembly every morning and you'd sing Christian hymns and you kind of like would all say a prayer. And, you know, we had the Christmas kind of like, you know, doing the nativity plays and, you know, everybody wanted to be Mary when they were little and I ended up being the donkey and, you know, just like, and so religion was a kind of, it was a natural, it saturated like, you know, your everyday life, the way it breaks up our years, our calendars, you know, breaks for the holidays and, you know, primarily Christmas within a Western context and, you know, Easter, that kind of stuff. So it was always around and I never really understood why, particularly this Jesus guy was such a big deal, because I was really into my Greek kind of heritage when I was younger, and particularly, you know, all the stories about the Greek gods and goddesses. And I just didn't understand why it seemed completely clear to me that Jesus was clearly like any other kind of Greek hero, in the sense that he had, you know, one parent was divine and the other parent was a human. And yet how come this was the one sort of religious constellation that has survived into the modern day, whereas all the other ancient sorts of gods and goddesses that I was interested in didn't. So that's what kind of like grabbed my intellectual curiosity about religion itself. And I wanted to understand more about what is it and what does it do to people. And that's how I kind of got into, eventually I went to university to study, I went to Oxford to do theology, which is a very traditional kind of Christian course about, you know, philosophy and history and Bible. And I was one, I was the only atheist in that kind of context as well. So I kind of feel like I'm satisfying my intellectual curiosity while at the same time being a bit of an anthropologist, studying all those people around me who are believers. So that's kind of how I got into being a professor of biblical studies and ancient religion.
It is a fascinating mix of story and literature, but also, as you've said, like the how those stories come up and become important due to the times and the, you know, challenges that people are going through. And they just, I remember too being excited to learn about the Greek mythology, because I'm like, oh sure, it makes sense that this is happening because this god is feeling this way, or you know, is punishing humans for something. But at the same time, the idea that humans could exist with gods and influence them and literally engage with them to make demigods, it was just a fascinating concept that we don't, you know, that we get in America, certainly get taught to us stories as opposed to the, I guess, certainty of religious text.
Yeah, I think that's the thing. I mean, one of the things that struck me when I was at high school, you know, really quickly struck me that somehow we were reading these religious texts, you know, Bible. We were reading these, this ancient literature in ways that was somehow different from reading other kinds of ancient literature. You know, I was like studying the Odyssey whilst also studying the New Testament. And the two were being treated in completely different ways by my teachers. And I didn't understand why that was. I mean, this is ancient literature. It's dealing with these kind of bonkers themes about, you know, like the impact of the heavenly realm into the earthly realm and the relationship between a deity and humans and, you know, with all the typical kind of stuff about, you know, punishment and destruction and also blessings and fertility and curses. And I was just like, well, why is this literature being treated in any different way? I mean, surely, you know, why should we read the Odyssey any differently than we read the New Testament text and vice versa? And so I think it was that sense that somehow, why was the Bible being treated as special, as different? Why was it being privileged culturally, you know, pedagogically, intellectually? Why was it being privileged in ways that other ancient literature wasn't? Yeah, you know, the Odyssey is you know, a cultural icon within the West. But the Bible, whether you believe it or not, like, this has shaped so much of who we are and what we do and how we think and how we respond. And we can't but help it. It doesn't matter if you believe it or not. The fact is that it holds huge sway over our cultural preferences and values. And politically so. I mean, I compare the situation, you know, in the States to the UK, and people in the UK are rightfully quite embarrassed sometimes, I think, about the place of religion and faith and Christianity within our legal system, you know, within our social systems. Whereas in the States, despite the fact that, you know, supposedly, you know, faith, the church and state are separate in the States, like in terms of in terms of, I suppose, the ways in which the structure of society, and yet the influence of the Bible in our lives, but particularly in American life, political life, is extraordinary. And so I think you have to take these texts seriously, whether you like them or not. You need to take these texts seriously. And the problem is that half the people that do take them seriously politically, socially, and use them as a weapon to beat other people with, they don't really understand what's in their own text anyway. So I think it's really responsible, not just, you know, culturally responsible, but I think it's politically responsible to be able to better understand these texts and where they come from, and to ask ourselves, well, why are we privileging these texts in ways that we wouldn't privilege others?
And it's also fascinating how prevalent the Bible is in society when it is not necessarily a clear and solid text. You know, you have not only the different testaments, you have the different translations, you have different religious sects kind of emphasizing different parts. So it's not as like go-to as the Iliad, which I'm sure has also gone through a lot of versions that before it came to be, you know, part of school curriculum, but like has those clear study guides that that administrators and teachers agree on, kind of like we've already decided what we want to get out of certain text, and yet we're still exploring the many facets of the Bible.
I think that's the thing. It's like, you know, people say to me, well, you hear it all the time. I mean, sometimes my students will say it in their essays or in seminars, and they'll say, the Bible says, and I say, no, the Bible doesn't say anything. The Bible doesn't have a mouth. It doesn't have a voice. It's people say that the Bible says, and it's all about interpretation, and our interpretive contexts are the things that shape and govern the ways in which we give authority to these texts to support a particular social or political or religious or, you know, whatever opinion or position. And I think one of the things that my students are really struck by is I quite often give them an exercise to do in a lecture where I show them three different translations of the same biblical passage, three English translations. And I get them to compare and contrast these translations, and they can't believe how wildly different they are. And everything from the use of punctuation and capital letters to the ways in which certain Hebrew or Greek terms are rendered into English, it changes theologically and ideologically the meaning of these texts. And I think that's one thing that quite often people miss, is that, you know, when they say the Bible says homosexuality is wrong, it doesn't actually say that at all. There is no word for homosexuality. There's no word for religion in the Bible either. And so there's a sense in which, you know, people can use these texts to support all sorts of different positions. And because of its complex nature, this is not a collection of texts that have been written by the same group of people. This is an anthology of ancient literature that's been very carefully crafted and reworked and recrafted and reworked and edited and shaped and changed and brought together, I mean, over hundreds of years. So even by, like, say, I don't know, the beginning of the second century CE in the Common Era, these texts were not fixed in form. Even before that, by the time of Jesus, if he existed, but in the time of Jesus, even the texts of the Torah weren't fixed. They were still very fluid and changeable, and what people thought was, you know, was scripture or holy revelation or Mosaic law was not fixed at all. And so the fact that these are this very kind of fluid, flexible, disparate collection of texts, you know, they did not come, you know, they didn't fall out of the sky written by the finger of God. Like, these are human made texts that have been changed over many, many centuries to suit different particular religious and theological, political perspectives. And that still happens to these texts today in different sorts of English translations, but also in the ways in which we choose to wield these texts normally against other people.
Right, yeah, and especially the idea that, as you said, it's not one voice, it is an anthology. It also is not, many of the verses aren't speaking about just one thing. Like, they're kind of these vague guidelines, and separate from the specific stories that really kind of have multiple lessons out of it, depending on kind of whose perspective you're focusing on.
Yeah, and quite often, I mean, these are just a selection of texts that were current and live in the ancient world and that meant something to people. So, you know, when you look at the New Testament, yeah, there are four gospels, which automatically tells you, okay, so there's many different versions of supposedly the life and miraculous, you know, actions of Jesus going around. But these are just four. I mean, we have so many more texts that didn't ever make it into the canon, you know, the official collection. That wasn't decided until the late 3rd, 4th century. And so there are so many more texts in which, you know, you've got incredible stories talking about Jesus being a kid and killing another kid and then bringing him back to life. And, you know, stories about the Virgin Mary's magic vagina. I mean, this is, you know, it's extraordinary, the range and wealth of early traditions, texts, Jewish and Christian texts that we have. So even then, you know, this collection that ends up being canonized and becoming this kind of icon, even then, those texts are just a small example of the varieties of early Jewish and Christian traditions that were really current for centuries and at the beginning of the first millennium CE. And people kind of forget that, you know, so these texts were not fixed in form. They were really, really fluid, all of these traditions and the sense of, you know, what is appropriate, what is holy, what is culturally or socially acceptable or ritually acceptable. All those things were like massively up for debate, which is one of the joys about like studying these texts, because you can see that tension and that debate and that discussion and that disagreement in these texts themselves.
So by exploring these texts, do you think that it helps atheists get a better understanding of religious people and possibly help us figure out better ways to communicate and work together?
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the things that I've learned is that, I mean, a lot of religious people get a bit annoyed by me because A, they say, you're an atheist, you don't understand. And then I say, well, actually, I'm a professor of Bible. I you know, and then they say, well, what right do you have to study the Bible? It's like, well, A, this is a human product. The biblical texts are human products. And as I've said, they're cultural icons. So the Bible belongs to all of us, no matter whether we're religious or not. And I think, you know, one of the things that really helps is that rather than trying to say to religious believers, when you're condemning gay marriage, when you're condemning abortion, when you're condemning various other sorts of practices that you claim the Bible says is not morally right, then you need to be, I think it's really helpful for atheists and secularists to be able to say, well, actually, you know, these biblical texts reflect a particular kind of social context in which the words that you're using, the constructs that you're using weren't operative. And equally, that these texts can mean all sorts of things. Yeah, we have some biblical texts that say that certain forms of sexual relationships between people of the same sex or gender are inappropriate. But on the other hand, we have other texts that celebrate the eroticism and the importance and the value of same-sex relationships in other ways. And so, you know, quite often you can, I think it really helps to be able to understand the Bible better in its ancient cultural context and to point out the ways in which it's completely inappropriate to weaponize this ancient literature against living, breathing, feeling human beings. It makes me very cross.
Well, when I think of also, you know, on a kind of pop culture side, with the movie Footloose, where they're using religion in the Bible to basically shut down the fun in the town until they come forward and show, like, well, actually, in the Bible, it mentions they rejoiced and they danced. And, like, did you forget about all of those fun parts that we can learn from?
I mean, and that's the thing as well, I think, because quite often, even extremely religious people for whom the Bible is important, they don't understand, you know, they deliberately distort and misrepresent these texts. Whether they know they're doing it deliberately or not is another matter. They're doing it because it suits their own particular perspectives. But that very common misrepresentation, for example, saying that the God of the Old Testament is evil and violent and nasty, whereas the God of the New Testament, the Christian God, is loving and kind and gracious, it's complete bollocks. You've got that loving, compassionate, kind deity is in the Old Testament. I mean, many times over than it is in the New Testament. And equally, that very violent side of God that you see in the Old Testament is absolutely there in the New Testament. I mean, these are all early Jewish texts. That kind of misrepresentation that can deliberately vilify or demean Jewish readers and owners of these texts from a Christian perspective, I think is abhorrent. Well, that's a strong biblical word to use. It's abhorrent. but I think that's the thing. I think the better we can understand these texts culturally, both in terms of their ancient context, but also the ways in which culturally we're using them and abusing them today, then the more helpful it is for atheists and humanists and secularists to be able to have constructive conversations and debates with those people of particular faith positions that think that we are somehow morally, politically flawed and ignorant, which is a word you often hear, or ignorant. You're ignorant of, you know, of God or of Jesus or of the gospel or of, you know, morality or whatever it is. But no, the more we know our stuff, then I think the more constructive and helpful we can have, you know, the conversations we can have with people of faith.
And, you know, as you said, that there's, you know, God is benevolent and evil and, you know, kind of like that whole range of emotions, not a pure black or white, good, bad situation, just kind of proves how human God can be, which you were exploring in your research for this book, God and Anatomy. Can you share a little bit about the research project that which developed, you know, how you judge and debate your source material?
Yeah, the book started off, I mean, I say in the book that this is the book I wish I'd read when I was at university, because this is why I went to university. I went to university because I wanted to understand, I was so interested in the mythology in the Bible, like all these myths and legends that I'd always been interested in terms of ancient Egypt and ancient Greece and ancient Mesopotamia. And I was at university and I was being told all the time that, you know, this is, you know, we're looking at the Hebrew Bible or Old Testament and the New Testament. And all the way through, I was being told that God didn't have a body, that God is immaterial, invisible. And I was like, have you read these texts? Like, because, it, you know, we have texts, we have stories here where, you know, Moses is up a mountain for 40 days and 40 nights and he's having face-to-face conversations with God. And God is like, you can see my form. I speak to him face-to-face as I would to a friend. Abraham goes for a walk with him. Jacob has a wrestling match with him. You know, Adam and Eve are walking in the garden and hear the sound of God's footsteps. I mean, this is like a very corporeal bodily deity. And I just didn't understand why so many of my lecturers and professors were saying, no, 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 this is all metaphor. This is poetry. And this was the God that I was more interested in. This was the God that seemed to me to be more like the ancient gods and goddesses of the rest of that part of the world. It seemed to me to be a God who was corporeal and more human and more interesting as a result, you know, more exciting, more engaging. And so, yeah, the seed was planted when I was like 18. And then I've obviously written several books before this. But this is the book in which I really got a chance to anatomize this deity. And the book starts at his feet and it works all the way up his body. And I'm using that male pronoun very deliberately. This is a very masculine, male-bodied god. So yeah, the book moves through his feet and his genitals, his backside, his belly, his chest, his arms, his legs, his face. Da, da, da. And it tells the story. It tells basically the early career, the early history of this deity. How did he move from becoming this one of many deities worshipped? He was a part of a pantheon, and he wasn't even the head of that pantheon. He was, you know, he was a son of the high god Ael. He was a son of God himself. And it tells the story about how gradually over time he became not just the main deity in this ancient Israelite culture, but then was gradually disembodied by various philosophical and theological and political moves. And I use the biblical text in that, but I also draw on a lot of archaeology and ancient iconography. The book is stuffed full of pictures of ancient artifacts to illustrate what I'm trying to say, explain about this deity, and to say, you know, when you read in this text that this is a deity who is covered in blood and his red is like, you know, he has this dark skin and this beard, this is the kind of thing that the biblical writers were assuming, because they always imagined that he had a body. What was remarkable wasn't that he had a body. What was remarkable for them was that he even allowed occasionally some people to see it. That was the remarkable thing. So that's what the body does, that the book does about God's body. And I suppose what I'm trying to do is to demonstrate that the Bible doesn't always mean what you think it means. Like, actually, it does. All of this, God's body is fully exposed in the biblical texts. And even those people, you know, other colleagues of mine, or priests and rabbis and vicars and pastors, you know, that this language is more than metaphorical. This language about God derives from the basic understanding that everyone assumed that gods had human-shaped bodies. So when in the beginning of Genesis it said, and God made man in his own image, that's not a metaphor. It's not trying to say that he made him kind of morally like him or spiritually like him. It means it was a visual correspondence between this deity and this man that he crafted from clay and blew air into his nose and mouth to kind of bring to life. So that's what the book is doing. And I suppose it's basically my way of trying to put the history and the culture and the sociology, if you like, and the anthropology back into this ancient deity, and to reclaim him. You know, he doesn't just belong to Christians and Jewish people and to churches and synagogues. Like, this is like a fantastic, you know, this is one of the old gods gone. He's completely different from the God that certain people worship today. You know, this is a very ancient deity. And what a shame that, you know, Christianity and Judaism moved away from that, because he's a lot more fun. I mean, he's brutal, but he's a lot more fun than, you know, than like the modern God of these monotheistic faiths today.
Well, and it's fascinating that, you know, the exploring the text not only gives us a better sense of like how to envision and imagine God, but also kind of reflecting on our own bodies and like the amazement of how everything it works together, and or like how people have similarities and differences. There's, I think, as you mentioned about the when God is seen and isn't seen, you know, that it also kind of gets me thinking about when the way that society interprets how much of the body you're allowed to show, or, you know, or when you're allowed to show it, who's allowed to show what.
Yeah. I mean, that forms a really important thread through the whole book, because I think the book is just as much about the ways in which human bodies were understood in the ancient world as much as how divine bodies were understood. And that notion of culturally, why do we cover some parts of our bodies? Why do we expose others? So even the story of, you know, what's extraordinary about that, Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, within Christian tradition in particular, from very early on in Christian tradition, this was understood to be somehow nudity was shameful, and it was sexualized, and it was deemed evil, and it became a very misogynistic trope in particular through Christianity, that somehow women introduced, you know, sin into the world through the sexual temptation of Adam. But when you read the story in Genesis, it's not about sexuality at all. It's not about morality. It's about the notion that what God fears the most is the humans basically discovering that they are godlike. And yeah. So the covering of their genitals, so, you know, there's a point where God says, he says to the other members of, like, you know, he uses this plural language. He's talking to the other members of his divine council, these other junior gods. And he says, oh, look, now they've eaten from the tree, you know, but, you know, they might eat from that second tree and eat from the tree of life and live forever and become like gods. And that's why, like one of us, that's why we have to expel them from this kind of heavenly place in which they're dwelling. And so what's really remarkable is that this is marked by essentially the creation of culture. It's a godlike capacity for the creation of culture. When they make clothes for themselves, Adam and Eve, like, they are doing what the gods have always done. When they leave the garden, they go off, they have, you know, they have sex, they have kids, they build cities, they make, you know, musical instruments, they, you know, they craft and create. And this is about the human capacity for the creation of culture, and dressing and covering parts of our bodies is a part of the creation of culture. And it's that's what that story is all about, that how godlike they become in their capacity to create culture, to become cultured beings. And so you compare that, the covering of Adam and Eve's genitals in that story, to this incredible image of God in the book of Ezekiel, where the prophet sees God sitting on his throne, a human-shaped deity, and like the top of his body is covered by this mysterious swirling bright light and fire, as is the bottom part of his body. And the only part of the body that the prophet leaves exposed as he's talking about what he sees when he sees God is God's motnaim, which is a Hebrew word, which tends to be translated as loins, but actually means genitals. So you kind of got this contrast between Adam and Eve, who as humans are now being forced to kind of cover their genitals, and then God himself, who exposes his genitals. It almost like marks that kind of contrast. So things like that, the ways in which human bodies are encultured, and the ways in which that maps onto or indexes certain notions of divine bodies, is one of the big things that I explore in the book. So yeah, it's just as much about, that was a very long way of saying, yeah, the book's just as much about human bodies as it is about God's body.
Did anything surprise you in your research? Kind of maybe like didn't expect to see an idea or so much of a certain body part covered?
Not so much about a certain body part. One of the things that I knew I wouldn't find much evidence for, simply because understanding that particular culture that these texts came from, was that in the Hebrew Bible or Old Testament, you know, some gods do defecate, they shit. So there's a brilliant story where Elijah, the prophet Elijah, one of Yahweh's prophets, is taking the mickey. Do you have that expression? I don't know, that's quite a British expression. Is teasing.
Okay.
Yeah. teasing the prophets of a rival god, Baal. And they're kind of petitioning this god to make it rain and to have a huge thunderstorm. And Elijah's saying, I know he can't hear you, you need to shout louder, you know, maybe he's gone on a journey. And he basically says, maybe he's taking a dump, is basically what Elijah says. So that the idea that gods could defecate was both hilarious in the ancient world, but also wasn't something, the biblical writers don't quite go that far to say that their god defecated. But then you get to like the early Christian period, and I'm using that very loosely. So there was this huge debate, which I didn't quite expect to find so much of, huge debates about whether Moses defecated and whether Jesus defecated, because these had like major theological ramifications. So that kind of surprised me, just how long people spent talking about whether or not Moses and Jesus could defecate. I feel like I said that word quite a few times now. But that was a huge, you know, it had hugely theological, you know, important theological ramifications. So that surprised me. It also surprised me how, actually it didn't surprise me, how irritating some of the stuff in the New Testament is, how misogynistic it is. I wasn't terribly surprised by that, but I was, you know, working through that material, just suddenly realizing that, my goodness, how anti-sex, how hostile it is to just the very act of sex. Mm-hmm. That hostility was extraordinary. And I think that hostility is there because when these texts were being written in, like, say, the mid first century CE, particularly the stuff that is attributed to St. Paul, so the mid first century CE, people literally thought, I mean, he was a part of this really kind of strange Jewish cult that were, you know, followers of Jesus, claiming that this guy had been killed and had resurrected. But they thought the world was going to end. There was no need to have sex because they all thought that, you know, with the coming of the kingdom of God, that Jesus's, you know, second coming was going to bring, that somehow their fleshy human bodies would be redundant and they would be kind of transformed, transfigured into this new heavenly existence in the kingdom of God, where there'd be no need for sex and so therefore no need for genitals. And so, like, this kind of really aggressive hostility towards the genitals and towards sex, that really kind of not surprised me, but it kind of was difficult plowing through a lot of that stuff, and particularly when it takes a very misogynistic turn and you just think, my goodness, and these are the texts that, you know, have shaped Christian cultures for centuries. And these are the texts that sometimes my very evangelical students will throw back at me and say, you can't teach me because you're a woman. Somehow it makes me less, just less than them, less than a man, less than the Messiah that they adhere to. So yeah, that was hard.
Yeah, I actually had a conversation with a former evangelical apologist who is now breaking away and become and getting more engaged with atheist communities. But he had I had mentioned how, like, I never quite understood this concept of why men had higher power in religious institutions and were kind of assumed to be smarter and able to comprehend religion better than women. And obviously, as a female who, you know, was kind of taught in present day that girls can do anything boys can do, it just didn't make sense. But also from a logical perspective, I felt like that was just such a clear example of patriarchy, you know, just trying to hold on to their power and make up excuses for why women weren't able to you know, reach their level. And it's as you said, it's not shocking because we know, but it still is sort of frustrating all of the examples that it comes out in.
Yeah, and all that stuff is enshrined in the Bible. I mean, this sense that there's a hierarchy of bodies, mm-hmm. because, you know, it's not just that God created humans in his image. Yeah, I mean, yes, I mean, not yes as in it actually happened, but, you know, yes, that's there. But also there's for a long, you know, throughout both Judaism and Christianity, but particularly in Christianity, there's been the sense somehow that male bodies, maleness, masculinity is a better reflection of the divine, the divine body, whether that's Jesus, you know, as God incarnate, or whether it's the notion of God the Father or whatever it is. But there's this sense that somehow male bodies are both the norm and are closer to God than female bodies, which are deviant because they are not male. And so there is this sense somehow that female bodies and womanness, if you like, is somehow less valuable, less worthy, is abnormal in some ways, a deviation. Hence all of that stuff, as you just said, all of this other stuff that comes with it, and that we carry that, you know, women of our generation, we carry this still. We carry that stuff that comes with it, that baggage that has been created by patriarchal systems and societies, which are deeply rooted biblically. They are rooted in the Bible. And you know, our cultures that we live in have been shaped by this stuff because they are Christianized cultures, whether we like it or not, they are Christianized cultures. And they put the Bible front and center. And so that's another reason why it's so important that as atheists, we engage these ancient texts and we engage the societies and cultures that produce them so that we can better engage the ways in which we are still being damaged by this biblical legacy in our own lives.
Yeah, and in the I admit when I first saw the chapter about God's genitals, I kind of giggled a little. And
yeah, of course.
You know, it's not the typical thing that I, as a non-researcher of sacred texts, see, but it did take me aback about how often violence and really brutal violence is connected with the sexual activity, and it becomes much more about power than pleasure or even reproducing, as religion, you know, tends to try to make the conversation about sexuality connected to always reproducing, but it really is much more of a power dynamic than I realized.
Yeah, and I think you find that in biblical descriptions and allusions both to human sex and sex, but you know, sex used as violence, as much as you do with divine. So there are some biblical passages that are deeply disturbing, that are not part of the Christian lectionary, that were not read aloud in synagogue in the ancient world because they are deemed to be too distressing. And these are in the book of Ezekiel, and they describe God having a sexual relationship with a young girl that is that we would recognize as being predatory and grooming and violent, and ends up, you know, with him instigating essentially gang rape and mutilation and killing, and all the way through these two texts. I mean, here, you know, this girl that God is described as having a relationship with, you know, she is representing, she's a personified people of Israel. So it's about his relationship with his people and the brutality and the trauma of that relationship. But, you know, it's the intense love and attraction and desire, but then that turns into a domestic abuse. And so even though that is metaphorical, all the way through those texts, the readers are saying, you know, and this is going to happen, this brutality, this sexual violence, this physical violence, this abuse, this harm, this killing will happen to all those women who disobey their husbands, who are unfaithful to their husbands, as Israel has been unfaithful to God. And you're like, this was read by, this is enshrined in the Bible. This was read by men. These texts are for men, by men, about men. But these are texts that are on the one hand saying, oh, it's just a metaphor that God has sex with a young girl. I mean, but on the other hand, but let's use this metaphor to say something real about what men should do to their wives if their wives are unfaithful to them or abuse them. You know, let's abuse them rather than anything else, because that's what God would say. So it kind of gives divine endorsement to horrific domestic abuse and sexual violence. So that is shocking. I mean, it is shocking. So when I'm talking about God's genitals in the book, it's not just, I mean, it is kind of, you know, funny in the sense that we never think of God having a penis or an erection or whatever. But, you know, it's quite normal in the ancient world that, you know, that gods were, you know, fertility gods were masculine. They were not feminine. People think that goddesses were, you know, the fertility gods. It's a complete misunderstanding. They shaped and nurtured life in the womb, but they were not the fertility deities. Fertility was a masculine divine attribute in the ancient world. So, of course, God has to have, you know, the God of the Bible has to have, be a fertile deity. He has to have these masculine features. And, but, you know, but thinking about what does it mean when this deity has genitals, is a sexual deity, and has these relationships that are couched as sexual relationships with, that are imbalanced in terms of their power, it's pretty horrific.
Sarah, which came first in the Christian church, do you think? Misogyny or religious distaste for sexuality?
Oh, God, they are so intertwined, it's difficult to know. I mean, in Christianity, if the question was about in church, in Christianity, there's a lot of evidence to suggest that women had had far more important roles in ritual roles in the earliest forms of Christianity, in the Jesus movement, than we are told. So I suspect that a distaste for sex came first, because they all thought the end of the world was coming, so there was no need to have sex, no need to reproduce, you know, there was no point. But I think misogyny actually emerged because it was always there. There's always been in any kind of patriarchal culture, and some forms of Judaism out of which Christianity emerged were already very patriarchal. Not wholly, but already somewhere. But I think misogyny particularly arises within Christianity as a means of disempowering the ritual role of women as authoritative leaders. And there were women who were leaders of early church communities, who were ritual players. And it's misogyny that ultimately ends up stripping them of those powers. And which is why, you know, we have these debates continually today about how appropriate is it for a woman to be a priest. I mean, obviously the Church of England over here has got, you know, female priests and female bishops, which is great. And the same is true of lots of forms of Christianity elsewhere. But still, you know, majority Christian communities like the Roman Catholic tradition, Greek Orthodox tradition, I mean, you can't be a ritual player. You can't be a priest if you haven't got the right genitals, which is ridiculous.
And then we also had a question. How much did Earth Mother fertility goddess impact the biblical God man image?
That's a really interesting question, because there are lots of there's lots of evidence to show that goddesses were a normal part of the world in which this particular deity Yahweh was worshipped. Yahweh himself had a consort, the goddess Asherah. We've got inscriptions that pair them together. The biblical writers are really kind of angry about Asherah and try to kind of like recast her as this kind of dirty idol that needs to be destroyed. You know, you shall not have a statue of Asherah or a cult image of Asherah in the temple of Yahweh, which kind of suggests that people did and it was completely fine. But yeah, so goddesses were, in terms of the Earth Mother, there's a theory that the oldest human religious expressions focus very much on a matriarchal model, so fertility goddess or earth goddess. And you find traces of these ideas. I mean, certainly the earth, the fertile earth, is very feminine in a lot of biblical mythology, even allusions to Yahweh sort of impregnating the earth in certain passages. But that older model that assumes that human religions began with this kind of focus on a maternal, fertile goddess figure and then were gradually displaced by patriarchal masculinist models, that model doesn't really, that's not widely accepted in scholarship anymore. It certainly looks a lot more complex. I think, you know, the maternal mother goddess earth figure is still really important, and I welcome actually the resurgence of this kind of practice among neo-pagan groups and a lot of environmental groups. I'm like, yeah, let's do it. Let's kind of correct the balance. And they're responding to the patriarchy and misogyny within mainstream monotheistic religions, which is great. Like, let's respond to that and challenge it. But yeah, I think, so we have traces of earth mothers, goddess figures, all the way through in most of the ancient religions from ancient Southwest Asia and the Eastern Mediterranean. But I don't think it's as simple as saying that the earliest religions were kind of goddess religions and about fertility and the earth that were then displaced or overthrown, if you like, by patriarchal masculinist religions. I think it's a lot more complicated than that, but quite how, we still don't know. I hope that answers that question.
Did, in your, I guess, research and opinion, how the concept of a virgin birth, you know, how, I guess, does that really play into the other concepts we talked about with sex and in the Bible? Because it kind of, you know, as you said, there was an emphasis on like the male need, but with the virgin birth, you're not, you know, God just kind of implanting, he's, you know, there is no actual act. And arguably that is kind of putting the mother on the pedestal as like the most important aspect of this creation.
Yeah, but I wouldn't say it's putting her on a pedestal. I'm saying it's just rendering her a vessel.
That's true.
She's very passive. And when she sort of says, you know, I talk about this in the book, like the bit in the Gospels where she kind of, you know, Christians celebrate it as this woman, you know, she says, you know, let it be as you declare, you know, I will do as you say, you know, when she's suddenly told that she's about to be impregnated by God and she's going to have this kid. And she's like, you know, but the language she uses, she says, you know, I am the slave of God. I've got no choice about it, is what she's basically saying. I couldn't protest even if I wanted to. I couldn't resist this even if I wanted to. But the idea of the virgin birth is really interesting because on the one hand, it's trying to avoid the idea that Jesus, that God himself has impregnated sexually, physically, a human, because by the time that these texts were written in the first century, the late first century CE, these are late kind of, the Gospels are later than like the writings of Paul, if you like, so by the time these texts are being written, the idea of God having sex with a human is just a no-no completely. But also common in other, at the same time that these texts are being written, is the idea that other great figures like philosophers, great philosophers were born as a result of a non-corporeal conception by means of a male deity inseminating mysteriously by means of the spirit. A human woman. So that is, it wasn't kind of like, as I'm not saying it wasn't unusual story to be telling or tradition to be telling, of course it was, it made it kind of remarkable. But yeah, like Jesus wasn't the only person credited with that kind of miraculous divine conception. And also the story is riffing off older, much older Hebrew oracles. So stuff like in Isaiah, there's an oracle, a prophecy that says, you know, a young woman shall conceive and bear a son and he shall be called Emmanuel, da, 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 da. Like the writers are trying to kind of make Jesus the fulfillment of this prophecy. It doesn't say anything about a virgin in the Hebrew, it just says a young woman. But by the time the ancient Greek translators that the gospel writers were reading, by the time they translated this word young woman, they were using a word parthena, which means virgin quite often, not always, but quite often. And so the idea that this had to be a virgin birth was really important. But you can see in some of the early gospel traditions that Jesus's divinity, he wasn't created with it. He wasn't born with it. It sort of came upon him in some traditions at later points in his life. For some, it was when he was baptized. For some, it was when he started performing miracles. For some, it was even when he resurrected. So that divine nature is not, you know, even though we've got these gospels and we read them, you know, we know the end of the story. But for a lot of like early Christians, like they were divided about when did he get this divine gift? Was it when he was conceived, or was it when he was born, or was it when he was baptized, or was it even when he resurrected from the dead? So there was a lot of, again, very fluid traditions around this. I hope that's answered that question. I feel like I keep going off on a tangent. I'm so sorry. It was about virgin birth, wasn't it?
And there's so many roads we can go down, because it is... you know, as you said, vast in terms of the information, the interpretation, the lessons we can derive. Actually, on the, well, one last thing about sexuality, we had a question do you agree with the claim that, and I don't know where the claim's coming from, but that the letters falsely attributed to Paul are far more misogynistic than the 7 authentic letters?
Ooh, interesting question. Yeah, so some of the letters, so that are some of the epistles in the New Testament are said to be written by Paul, but most scholars agree that quite a lot of them, you know, some of them are not written by him, that they're later, they're falsely attributed. They do tend towards a more misogynistic tone than we would find in the letters that are accepted as being of Paul or from Paul. Paul himself is quite misogynistic. It depends on who he's writing to. So there's a letter to the Romans or letters to the Corinthians or whatever. And there's different stuff. There's different stuff going on in those communities, whether it's in Rome or in Corinth. And he's addressing those different social, political, ritual, religious concerns. So he can be, he can, don't get me wrong, he is very misogynistic in a lot of his letters, very down on human beings, just generally, just doesn't like humans, just doesn't like people. But yeah, the later letters that are, most scholars think, are falsely attributed to Paul, or rather deliberately trying to hang on Paul's coattails, they do tend to be a bit nastier in pretty much every way. So yeah.
And then going back, the so you mentioned about the translations, one person asked, do you think that the whole issue of spirituality is based on translation misunderstanding? And the lead up to that question was explaining how Christianity, the word is the meaning of the word Christianity is associated with breathing, and even the New Testament, the original word for spiritual is.
All right, I know where this. Yeah, so pneuma.
Okay, yeah, I can't pronounce all these words, but that they're writing because they're using the Greek too. But that the psyche, the psychikos.
Yeah, so there's so I suppose just to answer that in one way, the division of spirit from matter, the division of like the divine from the non-divine, if you like, are features of early Greek philosophy, and you find it in different forms. They're not the same. So the Stoic kind of form is very different from the Platonic kind. I don't think you can say Christianity is derived from blah, you know, from this kind of a particular thing. I think Christianity was a Jewish, started off as a Jewish cult, and it took a long time for it to kind of realize that it was so different from its Jewish parent that it is either going to have to sink or swim, hence the anti-Semitism that you find in a lot of Christianity still today, but particularly in early Christianity as well. So yeah, I don't think you can sort of say Christianity is derived from a particular philosophical inflection of notions of spirit versus matter, or the ways in which the human being, not just body but psyche and everything else, plays out, and soul and stuff like that. So these are kind of philosophical constructs that were usefully mapped onto older texts and reinterpreted. Basically what you kind of got in the first millennium CE is the development of, well, the late first millennium BC into CE, is you start to get a transition from kind of good old fashioned ancient Southwest Asian mythology into cutting edge Jewish metaphysics, which is very heavily philosophically inflected by certain, particularly by Stoicism and particularly by Platonism, Neoplatonism. So
kind of the focus of your book with, again, God's body, and explore the idea that how the sacred text often seems to be coded in a lot of ableism, and you know, this idea that we were, you know, God is perfect and God made humans in his image, so we must therefore be perfect, and any change to our body or defect is often seen as an issue, but also in some forms it's been like rephrased as like a blessing from God.
Yeah, and that's what's really interesting. So particularly in an ancient context, as I said, there's a hierarchy of bodies, and you know, the ultimate body is the divine male body, and then bodies after that, you know, and then sort of bodies that are human but are not male or masculine, or and you know, there are degrees of masculinity in the biblical texts themselves, and so like us, you know, the gender was a spectrum too. I mean, the ancient world was fully aware of third gender, you know, transgender, gender queer, gender fluid, you know, all of these gender constructs were operating, not in the same way that they operate in our own world, but certainly there were more than two genders in the ancient world, and you find those in the Bible too. But what's really interesting, it always strikes me as troubling about, particularly about the Bible and ableism, is the way in which certain sensory impairments, certain physical impairments are used merely as props to glorify some heroic figure. So the most obvious example is in the Gospels, when Jesus is performing all these healings, you know, like healing the blind man and like healing the man that can't walk and healing the woman with the, you know, the flow of blood and all this kind of stuff. It's like these are, you know, no one asks these characters whether they want to be healed. Do you know what I mean? Mm. It's like, but they're used as props simply to, to reveal the kind of the miraculous transformative power of this Jesus figure, which is really troubling because there are all sorts of ways in which, in particular, sometimes these characters in the stories are far more appealing and far more likable and far more sociable and far more identifiable for us than this weird messiah guy going around like transforming people physically without sometimes not even asking them. I mean, you know, and so that there is a lot of, in that sense, that hierarchy of bodies and the problematizing and the othering of perceived deviances in bodies is deeply troubling. A lot of the texts in the older parts of the Bible, in the Hebrew Bible, Old Testament, a lot of those reflect ritual concerns rather than broader social concerns. So a lot of these texts are written by priests for other priests, and it's only later that they've become to be applied to all early, you know, early Jewish communities or whatever. So in that sense, you know, you sometimes get, you know, well, what do you do if, you know, you have a man who's got a leaky penis? You know, this is only, it's only problematic because it's ritually defiling, but only for a short period of time. So he can't go into temple, or he can't go into the sanctuary, or he can't perform certain things. It doesn't mean to say that somehow he is a flawed human being. Exactly the same as women who give birth. You know, how long do they have to be kept away from sacred space, you know, while they're bleeding postpartum? It's not that socially, within a broader context, these women would have been seen as impure or unclean simply by having children. It's just the impact that their leaky bodies have on sacred space or on their masculinist deity, who is kind of looked after by a very masculinist group of priests. So in that sense, sometimes we can read these texts, when we read these texts out of context, and don't realize that these were originally just written for sanctuary, you know, for ritual, for in sacred space, and yet these regulations have quite often been applied, you know, particularly within certain Christian and Jewish contexts, in both in sometimes today as well as in the past, they've been applied to all people with, you know, supposed defects, which is horrific again. But yeah, so there's a lot of it's a very ableist collection of texts on the whole, the Bible. And because it underlies a lot of our own cultural, legal, social, political preferences in our cultures, you know, we don't like it, but it has crafted those things. It's rendered us, our cultures, historically very ableist too.
Yeah, and it's also interesting to then get into that kind of question of how much control decision do we have over our bodies. So, you know, in like Jewish tradition, tattoo is not allowed, although in other religious traditions, tattoo would be sort of a sacred practice, especially, you know, not just having it, but even just the process to do it, and would be almost like a sign of dedication in a certain way.
Yeah, and that's interesting about that ban on tattooing is that, you know, this is body modification. And yet at the heart of Judaism is is body modification, is male circumcision. That's body modification, and as is tattooing. And those texts that on the one hand outlaws tattooing and alongside it outlawing other sorts of practices associated with very broadly speaking, the ongoing social relationships with the dead. So tattooing is put on a par with that. Whether that's historical or not, we don't know, but it's put on a par with those sorts of practices that the God of the Bible is like, I don't want you doing that anymore because that's abhorrent to me. Because, you know, I don't want you giving any kind of, showing any, demonstrating any social affiliate or ritual affiliation with the dead, because, you know, I'm the one that's the most important thing. So yeah, what's extraordinary is that on the one hand, you've got that form of body modification that's completely outlawed. And yet on the other, male circumcision, that is absolutely non-negotiable. I mean, it's strange how those sorts of preferences are then used to damage to damage certain people within a modern day context, in the sense that somehow you can do this with your body but not that. So God allows some forms of body modification but not others. It's very strange to me.
And also body maintenance, you know, like what practices are for our health, what medicine or surgery, or even just, you know, cleaning is recommended or considered uncouth, or, you know, or is, you know, so that idea that, like, how are we trying to continue the perfection or of of our body's upkeep, or are we recognizing that we, you know, need to take action, and we don't have sustainably perfect bodies the way that a deity does?
Yeah, I think it's about ultimately it's about the way in which, to what extent do our bodies mediate the relationship between this world and the next world, or another world, or the other worldly, or whatever. Mm-hmm. And I think that within all religions, bodies matter, because, you know, we're not separate from our bodies. We don't just dwell in a body. Our bodies are not vessels, you know, passive vessels. We are our bodies. That dichotomy between the mind and the body is a false dichotomy. We are our bodies. And so our bodies are the means by which we are socialized, and we are encultured, and we live. This is it. This is what we have. And so, of course, the body is one of the most important sites of religious practice for any religion. What you do to it, what you don't do to it, what you put into it, you know, what you do it with, and with who and how, and, you know, all of that kind of stuff. Particularly, you know, things like the holes in our bodies, you know, are very important. These are like the points at which things go in or come out are really always kind of like points of tension and anxiety within religious systems, as most cultures, human cultures. But yeah, I think the sense of perfecting the body, there is no perfect body. I mean, if the Christianity gets anything kind of vaguely right, if it gets anything vaguely right, it's the idea that, you know, this I mean, one of the things it gets wrong is that it makes the Messiah a man, which is really problematic, because, like, this figure was, you know, in other Jewish contexts, was very female, which is nice. But yeah, it gets the sense that, you know, the bodies are not the idea of the broken body. That's why that's thinking about an ableist reading and a disablest reading. Like, you know, some theologians take great comfort from this kind of broken body on a cross, the kind of the violence and the torture. I sound like Mel Gibson, don't I? But the idea that somehow this represents the notion that bodies are not perfect, and you cannot master the body in ways that we'd like to. You cannot perfect, there is no, you know, that the brokenness, the frailty, the damage is what makes us human. And there's a very strong theological trend within Christianity that really emphasizes that. And I think that's more important than saying, yeah, you know, this striving to be perfect, to look perfect, to be perfect, I mean, it's ridiculous. And you don't really find that notion of perfection in the ancient world in the same way. You do when it comes to masculinity. So the perfect masculine body within Greek and Roman culture is male. It's also kind of burly and fit and kind of oiled up and with a small willy. You know, it's you have these different forms of gender that are perfect, that are idealized. But in terms of the body, you want a body that is not out of place in certain contexts. So a menstruating woman is out of place in a certain religious context, but she's not out of place in other ways. The problem is not human bodies. The problem is belief in God, I think. And as we started at the beginning, you know, people say the Bible says this, or God says this. No, the Bible does not say that. God does not say that. It's people that say this shit. And that's where we come back full circle. It's about people can assert that the Bible says this or God says that, but it's about their own power that they're trying to project. They're not trying to, you know, they haven't got a hotline to the divine. There is no divine.
Was there difference in how God's body is based on where he is, like from earth or heaven or hell?
There's a sense, you certainly get a sense that early Jewish rabbis and the sages and the rabbis understood that he was a bit of a shapeshifter, that he could kind of like reveal himself in certain guises, not guises, he could reveal certain aspects of himself. So they say that, you know, when he rescued the Israelites who were enslaved in Egypt, he appeared to them as this great warrior, this like, you know, young, thrusting, masculine warrior. When he gave the Torah and the Ten Commandments to Moses and the Israelites on Mount Sinai, he appeared to them as a wise old sage or teacher. And then, you know, when Solomon built the temple, you know, God was this gorgeous, good looking guy. And so they were, you know, they were very comfortable with the idea that the different aspects, the different personalities or characteristics or functions of their deity, that the changing relationship, nature of their relationship that their ancestors had with this deity afforded him a different kind of look. But you do get, you know, one of the most striking texts is in Genesis, when Abraham goes for a walk with God and doesn't even recognize him. He just sees three guys sitting under a tree. He knows they're kind of unusual, but he doesn't quite know why. But these are human shaped, obviously, but they're also human sized. So Abraham goes, it's only, you know, that he realizes that it's God that he's walking next to. Whereas other texts present God as this kind of gigantic kind of colossus. So when he hides Moses on the top of Mount Sinai in a rock and puts this giant hand over him and covers him so Moses can't see the kind of the full glorious radiance of his, that kind of this light shining out from his body. But God there is supersized. So in that sense, context does dictate the sort of body that God is given. You find the same with a lot of early Christian texts as well, that many of which didn't make it into the New Testament, where, you know, Jesus changes for, like, you know, one minute he's this kind of massively bright white huge giant whose feet are on the earth and whose head is reaching into heaven. The next minute he turns around and he's suddenly transformed into this old man with a bald head and a beard and a nasty right hook. And so, you know, it's like that idea of kind of shape-shifting was quite common. But as for underworld stuff, they had all sorts of guises, but, you know, there was no sense when the Bible was written of like this kind of devil figure who was embodied and sort of had goat horns and sitting on a throne and sticking people with pitchforks. That's much later kind of medieval iconography.
So I got a question for us. How do people react when you correct their misperceptions about what the Bible says, particularly believers who claim to derive their faith from ideas that you then disprove? Do you see people changing their minds, doubling down, or something else?
Normally doubling down, which is fine. I don't mind that. You know, I'm not, one of the things that I find quite difficult about religious people, particularly certain sorts of Christians, because it's a part of their kind of mission statement, is the idea that they need to convert people. And so they will kind of, they're the ones that knock on your door and want to kind of like, you know, but that's a part of their mission statement. You know, they believe that it is their job to go out and convert. So yeah, normally it's when they kind of double down that I just say, well, fine, but I'm not going to carry on a conversation with you because I've got other better things to do. So I don't mind if they do, I just lose interest. But sometimes, you know, some of the best conversations I've had have been with some of my colleagues around the world who are Christian or who are Jewish, who are Muslim. And they're some of the best conversations I've had, because even if they agree with me or not about a particular way that we interpret an inscription or a text or a practice or whatever, they're not narrow-minded. And so the conversation that you can have is extraordinary, and you end up coming away. I mean, I have huge, I know it doesn't sound like it sometimes, but I have huge respect for people with faith. I think it's really hard to be, it's a commitment to be religious. I mean, it's not just unthinking. I think the kind of the most interesting religious people I've met are those who are very conscientiously struggling and committing to their faith every day. And they know it's a commitment because they're intellectually, they're thinking about it And they know it's hard to have faith. And they realize it's a cognitive and an emotional thing. And they're the most interesting people to talk to. So even if we disagree with each other completely, that's a conversation I always enjoy having, because I learn a huge amount from them, and learn a lot about myself as well when I talk to them. You kind of realize just how, you know, we are all in our own little boxes a lot of the time. And so having those conversations, I find really rewarding.
One person asked, you know, obviously we don't have book signings currently, but is there a way to get a personalized signed book plate?
I bet there is. And I think I will get my publisher onto it. But yeah, if you drop me an email, or that won't work either. It's something that me and my publisher have been talking about, and I'm sure that we can. So the best way to do that is probably, Emily, would you mind kind of, if I email you about it and my publisher, would you be able to kind of get something like that to somebody who wanted it?
Sure. Yeah.
I think we can find a way. I'm pretty sure
we can find a way.
Yeah.
I don't want to say what the plan is right now, but we'll figure it out.
I will talk to my publisher. Yeah. That's the only thing about COVID, isn't it? Because originally I was going to come to the States and kind of do some stuff, but yeah. Damn disease.
So obviously, along with reading your book, someone had mentioned that Brian Malley's book, How the Bible Works, is another one that they were thinking of, and they wanted to know if you could recommend any other books that people should consider to kind of round out the understanding of how the Bible and God works.
Oh yeah, well, with the Bible, the book that I can really recommend, and if you want to kind of understand like how it came into being, and I mean, I talk about it a bit in the book, but obviously only for a few pages, like, because I need to, you know, the book is about God's body. But for a book length discussion of how the Bible came to be, is a book by John Barton, B-A-R-T-O-N, called The Bible, A History, or A History of the Bible. I can't remember which way around the title is. It was published not long ago, maybe 2017. It's fabulous. He is a retired professor from Oxford University. He was my PhD examiner. He's a Christian, but he is a very, very sensible thinking Christian. And he's a brilliant scholar in my field. And so I would definitely recommend that.
So I'll drop the link to the book again. It's God and Anatomy. And I want to give you a chance, Francesca, to leave us with any closing thoughts or calls to action that we can take with us for the rest of the day.
I would definitely say, just get to know some of the Bible itself is like, it is an extraordinary collection of texts. I mean, some of the most beautiful poetry you can read, some funny stories. So just as an ancient literature, think of it as ancient literature and get to know it a bit more, I say, but particularly get to know the cultural context in which these biblical texts were born, because that can help us to have better conversations, more constructive conversations with people that don't understand why on earth there need to be humanists or atheists or secularists. The other thing I would say is that it would be great to engage a bit more with other people. I'd really look forward to engaging more with other people from different religions. I'm an expert in these particular biblically derived religions, but it would be, I'd really look forward to doing something, as we all should, with people from other different disciplines as well, from other religions too. So that's what I'm going to be doing.
But thank you so much for joining us. And thank you, Francesca, for sharing your wisdom and your book. I'm going to also invite folks to come to other programs from the American Humanist Association, and I will make sure to include the link to God and Anatomy with this recording, and You can go to AmericanHumanist.org to find out about our other programs, become a member, make a donation, and the recording again will be available at the AHA YouTube channel and the AHA Center for Education website. So from whatever time zone you're in, hope you have a great end of your day, and we'll see you later.
Thank you for having me.
Thanks.